You're welcome to Experience with Ifeoma. My name is Ifeoma Chibogu. On this program, we talk about the good, the bad, the not so good, and the not so bad. Today, our guest is Eunice Atuejide, a legal practitioner, businesswoman, and politician. In fact, the youngest female presidential candidate in the just concluded elections. Eunice will be discussing her journey through life with us. And we're going to be traveling all the way to the UK through technology to have a conversation with her. Eunice has conquered territories. She has pursued her convictions. In the process, she has been wounded severally. She has scars, but her healing is complete. Let's put a call through to Eunice. There's so much she has to tell us. I can't wait. Stay with me. Hello, Eunice. Can you hear me?
Now. Yes, I can.
Eunice, good to connect with you. Welcome to Experience on Ifeoma Speaks.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Eunice, how is the UK and how has life been since the presidential election?
UK is there getting hot. Life after elections. Oh, my God. What do you want me to say? Wow. Yeah, there's a lot of rebuilding to do. And yes, I've kicked off the rebuilding process and then connecting with the people, making sure that I'm present in Nigeria most of the time and, you know, doing the groundworks, because my race to the presidency is not just for 2019. It's until I get it, and I know I will get it. It's just what, when it will be is what I don't know. And I just have to keep doing what I need to do. I'm coming back very, very soon to continue from where I left off. The race is until I get it, so it's not, there's no pausing, there's no break, there's no in between. I'm getting the presidency. It's when that I don't know.
Interesting. We look forward to it.
Oh. You're one of the very few really sincerely optimistic people I know. Mm. And I'm so grateful for that, sincerely. It's hard to do what I'm doing, but people like you make it so much easier. And I bless God for every opportunity he gives me to meet more and more and more of your type. Thank you so much, Ifeoma. Thank you.
Thank you, too. Eunice.
Yes.
Suicide has become very rampant in Nigeria. What do you think? Is it an appropriate solution to solving problems or getting out of problems?
Definitely not. There's never a time suicide is the solution. It doesn't work. Like, you kill yourself, you go off to wherever it is you go to, and then what about the people you leave behind? You leave so much misery and all the opportunities you could have had to make your life better and several other people's lives better as well, you would have just thrown it out of the window because you gave up. There's never a time suicide is the option, is the right solution, is the only solution left. The life is dealing with you and then you give up just because life is dealing with you. No. That's for me, it's a no. It's getting rampant in Nigeria. Yes, there's the problem with the economy. There's a problem with the bad leadership, the poor governance. Everything is wrong with the leadership we have in Nigeria. It's causing a lot of poverty. It's causing a lot of despondency. But I always tell people, there's always light at the end of the tunnel. You just have to sincerely look for those silver linings. You will see them. And even if you can't see them, they are there. Just keep going. Eventually, you will come and you will see for yourself that they are there. And the opportunities will come and your life will get better. There's never a time suicide is the option. Never.
Thank you, Eunice. You have been raped severally, serially.
Tell me about it.
And scandalously. Yet you stand so strong. Tell us, what is your definition of rape? I want to be sure that we're on the same page and we actually understand what you have been through.
No, the definition of rape is when somebody has sex with you against your wishes. You do not consent to it and somebody has his way with you. The moment somebody puts his hand or his tongue or his body or any part of his whatever in you against your wishes, that's rape. And for me, there's nothing more dehumanizing than that. Whether it's happening to you as a woman or to you as a man, because I've seen, I have a lot of people who are men, like today men who were raped as boys. It is the most dehumanizing thing any human being can do to another. I don't think, I mean, I've suffered a lot of things, whether I talk about domestic violence or several things, but nothing put me down worse than getting raped. But at the end of the day, you can't survive all these things. You just have to focus your mind on the things that bring you joy, on the... sorry, I'm getting emotional. I do get emotional when I think about these things. But, yeah, it's hard. I have a few friends who are still alive today who went through similar experiences. And, God, sometimes I look back and I'm like, oh, Jesus, thank you for making me at least a bit stronger, because I can move past all of that and live my life. Some of them are not able to move on. And I know a few who killed themselves because they just couldn't take it. And there's also that guilt you feel. You don't even, it's amazing how you get raped, but you are the one that is feeling guilty about getting raped. You will see that people are blaming you. People are looking at you. You will just feel a lot of things that may not even be there. And then, give me a minute, Joe. Jesus.
I know, Eunice, I know. You know, when a girl is raped, she's blamed, like you said. People accuse her of dressing shabbily. She keeps wrong company.
God, tell me about it.
Nobody blames the men. They get away with it. And then most times you find out that the girls won't want to speak up because they don't want to be stigmatized. What do you have to say to a girl who is going through some challenge like this?
Exactly. The good thing is that I have been through it and I'm speaking and I don't care what anybody thinks. Yes, you get challenged. In fact, I put it in my book. And one of the reverend fathers that molested me badly when I was just 14, 15, some of the church members ran to me and were like, that's so not fair. Why would I go and expose him like that? Don't I have respect for the priesthood? Like, it was all about scolding me. Nobody was even discussing what they could do in order to, like, make sure that priests don't do such things to young girls, especially really young girls. If you have sex with a 22-year-old woman who consented to it, whether you're a priest or not, it's on a different level. But when a young child is looking up to you to receive the blessings of God through you and receive teachings about how to live her life and, you know, do the things that are right for herself and for humanity, and your response to that is to beat her up and try to drug her and try to rape her or rape her and everything, then you should be scolded, you should be called out, and you should be punished if possible. And then I went to the police station, and the police people were, like, literally scolding me, shouting at me and threatening to arrest me because they believed that it was my fault. What did I do? Why did I enter the room with him? Why did I not go home when the event finished? And then why are you wearing that skirt? It's too short. Why did you do your hair like this? Like, I'm like, guys, I came in here exactly as I left that location because the police station is just a stone throw from where this happened. Just that you guys can see what I look like. Take your evidence and go after this man. But what you're doing is scolding me and threatening me with arrest and blaming me for one animal. I'm like, God, man, we have a long way to go and it needs to be done quickly because I'm so sure several of our girls are getting molested as little children, are getting raped as young women, young girls, and the perpetrators are getting away with it. They're getting away with it because everybody is more concerned about the stigma, about the fault of the woman for not dressing up in a particular way, forgetting that even those ones who dress up in a particular way still get raped. It's not about how we are wearing. It's about the animals and the animalistic tendencies in these men who see us and then decide that, okay, I can conquer her and then force myself on her. You get raped because you're dealing with an animal who doesn't realize that you never, ever, ever touch a woman who says no. There's no reason. You don't even need to beg. She don't say no. You walk out. Leave her alone. It's the same for the boys. You hear about girls raping, like all these house girls coming in. I have a lot of friends. When they are adults and they're talking about it, they don't feel traumatized, but I feel bad for them because even though they didn't realize they were getting used and molested at that time, it is what it is. You have these house girls, they come in there, an 8, 10, 12, 14 year old child, they start to entice the child and get his penis rising up and then sitting on him or whatever, or getting him to like perform oral sex on them. Like, you hear these stories when they are adults and you're like, oh my god. And then you even see these women, you know them, and you're like, my, as in, this person was doing this to you at that age. And she's here being a deacon in the church and talking as if she is the most holy person. I mean, I don't want to judge anybody, but sometimes we need to look beyond what people are presenting to us. We need to talk to our children and make sure that some of the things they are experiencing in life, we can take it away as quickly as possible and then also protect them. Because sometimes it's actually the overbusy parents or the lackadaisical attitudes of our parents that cause us to be exposed to some of these things. And then when we even come home, they don't even pay attention. They can't see the pain we are suffering because they are not looking at us. They are looking above us. They are not seeing that we are suffering because it's always about the next meal on the table. We need our parents to pay more attention and to at least know their children so that when things start to change, you will notice it and you can follow through until you discover what exactly is wrong with your child. I'm lucky. I know I'm one of the lucky few because I tend to deal with issues a bit, even as a child, a bit more maturely than most. So I'll go in there, I'll think about myself, I'll try to purge myself of all the negativities and then focus on the things that help me to be better and help me to move forward in life, and then I just go. You know, but it's not the same for everybody. It does go down to parents. And please, all of you who have been getting raped, don't blame yourselves. Don't blame yourselves, please. It's not your fault. And everybody, I do reach out to people, anybody that wants to talk, look for my handle and just inbox me or text me or whatever way you need to reach out. I am here for all of you because I've been through what you're going through.
Thank you, Eunice. You know, you have gone through a lot. Rejection, domestic violence, deceit, hardship, struggles of varied kinds. And those moments must have been very traumatic. What kept you going? What was the driving force?
Like I said, it's just that understanding that, like, a lot of it is self reflection. You have to be able to be honest with yourself. Focus on the good things because there's always something good about every situation you find yourself. Once you do that, you plan on how to get away from the pain, because it is a very painful experience sometimes, whether it is the rape point or the domestic violence type of the deceit parts or the duping you and taking away your money or the losing your best friend, or, you know, like a lot of things, whether it's bereavement or loss of physical, whatever it is, they bring pain. But then go away from that pain into the positive things and then try and deal with that pain as well. You may not be able to do it on your own, so it's sometimes really good to have friends or people you can trust and people you know would not take your stories and start making fun of you, but actually look at what you are talking to them about. Listen, and then hopefully even give you a shoulder to cry on if that's what you need. Give you that hug. If all you need is just that hug to feel like somebody loves you or cares about you, hopefully you find one person around you that could just be that rock for you. And then, but even if you don't, try and be it for yourself.
Nice. Eunice, I read your book. The Girl Who Said I Can. Eunice, that book is a mind blower. You bared all. There was no hold back. I read that book, and I want to tell you that I have read it over and over and over again. It's a wonderful gift to the world. You're a survivor. I just keep wondering how you could have risen as many times as you have fallen.
I can confidently tell you that there's always light at the end of the tunnel, no matter how bleak
I believe you.
Always.
Yes. Yeah. And while reading that book, I got to realize that your greatest gain in life has actually been in your pain because of lessons learned.
I think you're right, because I learned my lessons in a way that I actually tried to take something good out of absolutely every bad experience, whether it is the maltreatment as a child or the molestations as a child, or I really look out for the good things. Like, okay, if this had not happened, would I be able to do this? You know, like, okay, if I hadn't gotten sent back when I went to Enugu to see my uncle without food, without transport or anything, would I have realized that you can actually persist? And even though you don't have money, somebody will actually let you stand in a bus all the way back to Lagos just because they want to be, you know, helpful to you. So somehow you just see that, okay, it wasn't even that bad. And then you see also that, but if he had given me money and given me other food, I wouldn't have been determined enough to make something of myself. I would have become dependent, and in the end, I would have not been able to go where I want to go when I want to go, because I would have had to wait for somebody to approve. When I reflect, I look for those things. I know there's a lesson in that experience. So I look for that lesson I can take on and then do better as a result. I'm a very happy person at the end of the day, because I do take the positives from every situation, no matter how bad.
And I want to tell you that you are actually the girl who said, I can. Eunice, you are that girl. The girl who said, I can.
Thank you so much.
So where can people get copies of the book? I understand that well-meaning Nigerians have been sending in sponsorships. How does it work?
It's amazing. At the point, I gave out some. Like, I just went to some towns where I was still campaigning, or was it even after the elections? I can't remember. I was still campaigning, so I was in Uyo, and then I gave out some. And then the feedback, I mean, that was actually how it gradually became a process, became something I want to do. I want to use as a system of reaching out to younger Nigerians, particularly the people between the ages of 14 and 30. I just realized I could help a lot of these young people. And I'm so happy. So I started calling my friends, please, let's get more books out there. And yeah, I did get quite a few friends who brought money, and I produced some more and distributed. And yes, the way to do it is basically to just reach out to me. I'm on all the socials, at least the major ones, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and it's at Eunice_Atuejide. That's at Eunice_Atuejide on Twitter and Instagram. And then, of course, my phone number, 0814-246272. By WhatsApp, though, I don't take calls. If you send me a WhatsApp message, if it's necessary to call you, I'll call you. So, but once you reach out, then you tell me how many copies you want to sponsor, and then I can get those ones made. And whether it is to send to you directly or to distribute on your behalf, anyhow you want to do it, the important thing for me is to reach out to so many more young people, help them so that they know that all these things they see on the social media, loving the most expensive clothes and whatever, and seeing a lot of crap that is not real. Of course, there are some celebrities out there showing off what they have acquired. But we need to understand that nobody is chasing you. The only person you are after is yourself. The only person you are competing against is yourself. You know, do what you have to do to make sure that your life gets better. But forget what everybody else is doing. For goodness sake, it doesn't matter how many wristwatches or cars or houses or whatever they build or buy. It does not concern you. So let us develop more confidence about who we are. Project more of ourselves instead of looking at what other people are doing, most of which is even fake. And then we put pressure on ourselves, and before we know it, we're thinking that, man, I'm the only one who is not successful. Let me go and kill myself. I don't even know. I can't even. I have.
Thank you, Eunice. I wish I could. Thank you so much. Your story lights up lives with hope and inspiration. It's so amazing. It's really so amazing.
Thank you.
So if somebody wants to sponsor the book, the person gets in touch with you on either your WhatsApp or your social media handles?
Yes.
Okay, yes, and then the person can pay for some number of copies so that young people can get the copies for free.
Yes, for free, yes.
We've very nice,
quite
lovely.
A lot for free. And I mean, the response has been amazing. Like you said, you read the book, so I'm sure you feel what some of these kids are feeling. They are seeing somebody who they think is up there, but they are actually identifying with me and realizing that there's nothing to any of those things. It's just about who you are. And who you are is all that matters. Be yourself. And no matter who you are great exactly as you are. And they're learning this. And I'm so happy that I can influence them in that way so they stop worrying about what people are pressuring them to think is the standard they must meet in order to belong.
Thank you so much, Eunice.
Yes,
thank you.
Thank you too.
It's been wonderful talking with you on Ifoma Speaks.
Thank you.
The experience.
Thank you,
thank you. Thank you for sharing your journey of discovery, recovery, and self-validation in your book.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ifoma. I'm so grateful. Thank you.
Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.
You too, my love. Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Listening to Eunice has been awesome. All right, viewers, it's experience with Ifoma. My name is Ifoma Chibogo. If you have any experience you'd like to share with me, get in touch. I'm on all social media platforms, Ifoma Chibogo, Ifoma Speaks. And please subscribe to my YouTube channel, Ifoma Speaks TV. Until our next episode of Experience with Ifoma, thank you for joining us. Bye.